Once you find Galatians chapter 2, we're also going to be a little bit in Matthew as well, but we'll get to that here in a moment. Galatians chapter 2, verse 20. Galatians chapter 2, verse 20. And the word says, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you tonight for your word. We thank you, Father God, for your spirit, which guides us into truth. And I pray, Father God, that as we gather in this place, seeking discipleship today, seeking to grow and to learn from you, that, Father God, we would be increased, that we would move to another level of understanding, another level of living, Father God, because that's what you've called us to, a life of blessing, a life of abundance, Father God. And it's my heart and my prayer tonight that your word would move us one step closer to arriving at your glory. Now, Father God, as everything that's said and done in this place, we pray that it would glorify you in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, as we approach this season of remembrance, this Easter season, Sunday is Palm Sunday. And for those of you who are not familiar with what Palm Sunday is the day that Jesus made his triumphant entry into Jerusalem 1 week before he was going to be crucified. So this was the event that really led to what we ultimately celebrate in Easter, which is his death, burial, and his resurrection. Amen? So what I want to do, and I thought that it would be appropriate if I begin to kind of talk a little bit about the crucifixion, but not so much in the sense that what Christ went through, but more of how his crucifixion relates to us. Because the verse that we just read, our passage for tonight, says, I am crucified with Christ. Everyone say, with Christ. So we need to understand that the crucifixion is not something that Jesus went through for himself, but it's something that he went through to show us that we can go through it as well. Because we are to be crucified with him. It would be almost as if we were like the thief that day, being nailed to the cross right next to Christ, because the same punishment that Christ endured, the same torture and the same heartache that he suffered, we need to understand that there's going to come a time in our life where we're going to have to go through that same suffering if we're going to live as he's commanded us to live. See, Paul wrote to the Galatians, and it was his intent on sharing the fact that he was dedicated to the service of God. When he wrote to the Galatians, what he was telling them is, hey guys, I want you to listen up. I want you to understand that I am dedicated to Christ. Amen. That I'm no longer living for myself, but I'm now living for God. In fact, that guy that you used to know is now dead. Understand, the man that you used to know is no longer living, but I'm now a different person living for Christ. So let's talk a little bit about Paul, because you understand that Paul had once been known as Saul of Tarsus. Now, Saul of Tarsus was the kind of man who would brag, who would say, you know what, I was circumcised on the eighth day, just as the law commanded. He said, I was a Pharisee among Pharisees. I was of the tribe of Benjamin, you know, the ones who were better than all the rest. That was me. I was Saul of Tarsus. I was a Hebrew of Hebrews. And when it came to the law, I was blameless. You know, that Saul of Tarsus. The Saul of Tarsus who persecuted the church. The one who persecuted the believers. The one who stood there and instigated the murder of Stephen. The one who held the coats of the men as they stoned him to death. That Saul of Tarsus. The Saul of Tarsus who went to the government and said, why don't you give me some papers so that anytime I find a Christian, I can just execute them right then and there and just get it over with. The Saul of Tarsus who said, I'm doing this because God has called me to do it. He was the one who persecuted the believers. But he's the same Saul that had an encounter with Christ on the road to Damascus. Because Saul was on his way to Damascus one day when all of a sudden a bright light shone all around him and he heard a voice from heaven that said, Saul, why do you persecute me? And falling to the ground with his face into the earth, Saul says, who is this that's speaking to me? And Jesus says, it is I, the Lord, whom you persecute. And from that moment forward, Paul was struck blind and had to be led around. And they took him to a small town and they took him into a house and he stayed there. And for 3 days, he was blind. Until Ananias, a disciple of Christ, came and prayed for him that he would receive his sight and that he would be filled with the Holy Ghost. And the moment he laid his hands upon him, he said the scales fell from his eyes and he began to see. And from that day forward, he was baptized. And he said, from this day forward, I am going to live for Christ. The man that I once shunned, the man that I once persecuted, the man that I once... I don't know this, but I would imagine that Paul was probably in the crowd that day screaming, crucify him. I can't prove it with Scripture, but I would imagine he probably was. But yet that man says, you know what? I'm different now. I've come into contact with Christ and I'm no longer that same person. The Saul of Tarsus that you once knew is now dead. And now I, Paul, live for Christ. I live for Christ. And that's what he's saying. He's saying, I live for Christ. He says, the life that I live is no longer mine, but it is lived in Him. When we become Christians, we need to understand that we become new creatures. The old things pass away and behold, all things become new. The life that you used to live, the sin that you used to carry, has now been removed from you and you now stand in Christ. Amen. A new creature, a new person, with a new name, with a new nature, with a new character, with a new standing with God. That says you too are blameless in my sight. The old man has been crucified with Christ. That old man is now dead. That man that stands before you tonight is no longer the man that used to be, but he's a new man. Amen? He's a new man. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 19 through 20 says this. Know you not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost which is in you, which you have of God, and you are not your own? For you were bought with a price. Therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. You've been bought with a price. When Christ hung upon the cross, when He gave of His life, He did it so that He could purchase you back from the kingdom of darkness. When Adam sinned, he turned over humanity to hell and to the devil. He forfeited everything that God had given him to Satan himself. And now here comes Jesus, and Jesus says, I'm going to die, and when I do, I am going to pay your ransom to bring you out of that. In other words, it's as if he has come in and said, how much does this one cost? And Satan says, well, that one's going to cost you more than you can pay. And Jesus says, oh, no, I can pay as much as it takes. And he purchases you back and you become his. And you become Christ. That's what Jesus is doing. You have been bought with a price. And that price is the blood of Christ. That means you no longer belong to yourself. How many people have a car parked out in the parking lot today? What if I took your keys, went to your car, drove it off the lot, down the street, and sold it? Do I have a right to do that? Absolutely not. That's called stealing, right? You've been bought with a price. You don't belong to yourself. So why do you sell yourself when you don't belong to yourself? You've been bought with a price. You don't belong to yourself anymore. When you become a servant of Christ, you now say, you know what? I don't want to belong to me. I now belong to you. So when you call me to go to Africa to be a missionary, that's where I'm going to go because I don't belong to myself anymore. I belong to you. When you call me and say, you know what? You need to take your new car and you need to bless this person with it. Got quiet real quick. It don't belong to you. Your life no longer belongs to you. It belongs to Him. In the book of Romans, Paul says it this way. Chapter 1, verse 1, he says, Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ. The word servant has the connotation of slave because he understood that Christ had purchased him. It was as if Paul was standing on the auction block that day and Christ came along and said, I'll take him. And purchased him. And now he has become the property of Christ. More specifically, the word translated servant means a bond slave. In the Old Testament, if you had a debt that you could not pay, you could become an indentured servant to the person you owed. You became their servant. You became their slave. And you would work until the time that your debt was paid off, at which point you would go free. You were a slave. But for some people, after their debt was paid, they said, you know what? Even though I no longer am bound by law to you, I love you. You have been good to me. You have treated me well. You have treated my family well. And I realized that if I was out on my own, I'm going to end up in the same mess that I was in before I met up with you. So as a result, even though I'm not obligated to, I'm going to make the choice to stay with you and be your servant. I'm going to be your servant even though I don't have to. I'm making the choice to be your servant. We've got to make that choice. When you choose to come to Christ, and I've heard people say, well, I don't do anything to get saved. Yes, you do. You make a choice. You make a decision that says, from this day forward, I'm going to live for Christ. I'm going to become His property. I'm going to become His servant, His slave. I'm going to become His bond servant. And the moment they would make that decision, they would take them down to the temple. And they would say, this man has decided to become my servant of his own accord. And the priest would say, is that true? And they would say, yes. And they would take them to the door of the temple and they would press their ear against the door. And with an awl, they would pierce their ear. And that piercing, that hole in their ear became a symbol that said, you know what? I have made the choice to serve this man. Amen. They were pierced. Yes. They were pierced. To show that they were willing to serve the man of God. We had to submit to the master. We're not forced into slavery, but when you become a Christian, you make the choice to become a bond servant. We've chosen to be pierced. We have, of our own will, chosen to be his slave, and as a result, we are no longer free to do what we want to do. But we are now under the command of our master. We must do His will. Jesus calls us to be crucified with Him. In fact, in Luke chapter 9, verses 23 and 24, He said to them, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself, stop doing what he wants to do, take up his cross daily and follow me. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it, but whosoever will lose his life for my sake, the same shall save it. In other words, he's saying, look, if you're going to be my follower, if you're going to be my disciple, if you really are going to choose to be my bondservant, then you're going to have to stop doing your own thing and you're going to have to start listening to me and doing what I'm asking you to do. I'm not going to make you do it, but I'm going to ask you to do it. And you have to make the choice. Now, we could understand that when we take up our cross daily and follow Him, that means that we take up our cross because our flesh decides to rise.